Hey guys, it's Leanne, and I'm here today with my February wrap-up. Before I get into all the books that I read in February, which I promise I will do, a little bit of housekeeping, two announcements, I guess. First, just wanted to let you know that I did decide to start a Patreon, so that is linked down below. Nothing will change about what I do on YouTube, just generally. It's just if you feel like you wanted more of me, for some reason, God knows why, that's a thing that I am now doing. JSYK, when I set it all up, it's all just a bunch of references and jokes to my favorite things. So I apologize in advance for that. Pretty sure only I find it amusing, interesting, or funny. But like the tiers that I created, the names for them, how I described what they are, the notes that you get if you sign up for a particular tier. It's all just like dad level nerd jokes about the fandoms that they're referencing. So again, apologies in advance for subjecting you to that, but if you're wanting to support me, you can't possibly be shocked at what you will find there because it is me to the max. So anywhoosies, just want to let you know that's a thing. So there you go. Second announcement is that spur of the moment last minute, upon watching the Shadow and Bone trailer, me, Jessie from Jessie Mae and Jashana, fellow booktubers of mine. If you don't know them already, please check them out. I'll have their channels linked down below. The three of us were like, we want to reread the Grisha trilogy because we watched that trailer and we were like, I want to be in the Grishaverse again. I can't wait until this drops. I need to be there now. So we were like, well, why don't we reread the books? So we are like spur of the moment, last minute, kind of doing like a Grisha long reading thing. So we've got about 6 weeks, well, at least when we decided this, we had about 6 weeks between then and the show dropping. So we figured 3 books, 6 weeks, 1 book every 2 weeks. So that's what we're doing. It's not on my TBR because that's how last minute it was. We decided it after I'd already filmed my TBR. So in addition to what I said was on my TBR, I also now have Shadow and Bone and Siege and Storm, which are the first 2 books, and then we're gonna read Ruin and Rising in April because the schedule will be like end of March, beginning, no, mid-March, end of March, middle of April. And that puts us like right on target for having finished all the books before the show drops. So there will be live shows accompanying this. The first live show to talk about Shadow and Bone will be on my channel, mid-March. Oh fuck, please don't fall. I'll leave in the description like specifics about like dates and times. We're still kind of like 100% pinning that down. But it will be like the second weekend of March, the last weekend of March, the second weekend of April, like thereabouts. So again, I'll leave that in the description. So the first live show will be on my channel, the second live show will be on Jashana's channel, and the third live show will be on Jessie's channel. So please join us. If you've never read the series, now's a great time. If you have, then join us in rereading it because we're super pumped and we know we can't be the only ones that are super pumped. So let's read some Grisha books. Cool. Now, let's do what y'all are here for, and that is to wrap up what I read in the month of February. This seems like it was forever ago. First book that I read was Infernal by Mark DeJager. This was sent to me by the publisher, and it was actually a re-release. Like, I believe it originally came out like 4 years ago or something, but it was newly sold to Solaris slash Rebellion, I believe is what happened, like with a new cover and everything. This book started out really strong, and I thought, I was like, oh, this is gonna be like a 4-star, I think. And then it fizzled. So the opening, the premise is like this guy wakes up and he doesn't know who he is. It's like the Bourne Identity, except fantasy. So he wakes up, he does not know who he is, he doesn't know that he has powers, and then when he finds that he does have powers, he doesn't know where they come from, what they are. He seems to be possessed by like a demon-like entity, but he's not totally clear on that either. Like, is he possessed, or is that just like, has he always been this way? Like, do his powers come from this? Like, he's like very not sure about anything. And so he also doesn't know really anything about the world he's in. He's just like kind of there and he's like, I don't know. And the way people are reacting to him, he's like learning who he is based on that. So, like, it's a super cool premise. And I honestly think the author handled it so well. Like, having the reader be in the head of somebody who doesn't know who they are, like, that could be really bad. Like, you as the reader might have a great deal of difficulty latching onto a character like that, or you're already struggling to understand a new fantasy world, and if your own, like, the main character you're following also doesn't know who even who they are, like, you as the reader would be like totally in the dark. So I feel like the opening and the premise was executed very well. But then when the plot started to get going, and we started to like learn about this world and become embroiled in the politics of this world and become involved and like meeting the powers that be and like all of that. Once that began to shake out, it felt quite cliche and trite and boring, and it totally lost me. So I felt very mixed about it. I think I gave it either 2 or 3 stars. Because, like, again, pulling off the premise in the beginning, it was impressive. I thought it, I was like, wow, that's solid. But by the end, I was so, so bored with it. So I don't know. I mean, it is the first book in a series. I really don't care about where this is going now. I might read on, because like there's clearly promise in the author's style because of their ability to execute something so tricky in the beginning. So I don't know. I might give the next book a chance. I don't know. I feel mixed about this. I had a very similar reaction to the next book I read, which was Outlawed by Anna North. Once again, it started out really strong and I was sucked into it immediately. I was not sure if I was going to be into this because it's this sort of like feminist Western thing, and I'm not the biggest fan of Westerns at the best of times. This cover is the worst cover I've seen in my life, and I was worried I would find it boring. And the beginning, I loved. I immediately felt invested in the character. I thought, generally speaking, the character work was really authentic and really fun to follow. It felt kind of like some of my favorite memoirs, where it's like, it's very like mundane things going on, but this is the life of this character, and like you're really like sinking into the life of this character and their experience and their understanding of the world. So I was very into it in the beginning. But then like halfway through the book, it began to just be a bunch of soapboxing about feminism. Like all of the situations, all of the characters that were introduced, all of the dialogue, everything was just like an excuse orchestrated to have an opportunity to soapbox. And a lot of the themes explored here are really great themes that could have been explored really well. And even the things that happened in this book could have happened, but this was so short that it felt like we just like rushed to the next soapbox. And I feel like if this was a longer book and we really spent more time with these characters and developing the lives of these outlaws and the hardships facing them, and along the way we had some kind of like feminist things happening or feminist points being made, they wouldn't feel so in your face yelling at you about it, because it wouldn't be the only thing that's going on. It would be a thing that happens sporadically when it feels natural for it to and authentically springs up. It just felt like it rushed right to the message. And I mean, then it's not a book anymore. So the beginning character was so good, but nobody else really got that kind of character work. And then we end up with a whole bunch of characters. And I honestly, with all the outlaw characters, I kind of couldn't tell them apart, some of them. A couple stood out because they were slightly more like unique and had a more important role in the story. So they were a little more fleshed out. But a lot of the outlaws, I was like, I can't tell you apart. And we're just like rushing along through and I don't care. So it started strong and then fizzled. So I think I also gave this one 2 or 3 stars because I was like, originally I liked this. Originally I liked the writing style. In theory, I like what you're doing, but I don't think you did it well because you were in a hurry. Slow down and tell a story. Don't just skip right to the bombastic soapboxing. The next book that I read was The Stone Sky by N.K. Jemisin. This is the third and final book in the Broken Earth trilogy. I posted a non-spoiler discussion about the Broken Earth trilogy after I finished this. Needless to say, I highly recommend the Broken Earth trilogy. It is like nothing I've ever read before. And as I said approximately 1 billion times in my discussion video, this is the kind of series that defies synopsis or review because it's just so unlike anything else out there that it's not a thing you can really like compare to other things. You can't really pick it apart the same way. It's just such a unique project that it's just a category unto itself. And all I can say is that like what the best I could do in terms of explaining the kind of experience that you're signing up for when you pick up these books, like I did my best in that discussion, but it's not a thing that's easy to like pin down. So I would highly recommend the series, but like with some asterisks, those asterisks being laid out more in depth in my discussion video. So if you really are wondering whether or not you should pick up this series, I would recommend that video because it's the best I could do to try to explain what you're gonna get out of these and like why I absolutely recommend it if that would appeal to you. Oh my god, so good, chef's kiss, incredible. The next book was These Violent Delights and I DNF'd it. This is the first book that I DNF'd this year and probably the only one because I very rarely DNF books. I usually finish everything that I start, because if it's bad, I want to discuss why it's bad so that we can all learn. Or if it's great, then I want to review it. But in either case, like, I kind of feel like it's a bigger waste of my time if I read a book only part way, because I don't review books that I have DNF'd. So just mentioning it because it was on my TBR and I didn't not get to it, I DNF'd it. I will not be reading this book ever. Why? Because it was badly written. And everything that I could find, because again, I did look up some reviews when I was like, I think I'm going to DNF this. But if I found a bunch of reviews that were like, oh, it starts bad, it starts tropey, it starts slow, but it really gets going, and it's really worth it, then I would have persevered and carried on. But most of the reviews I saw led me to believe that it would not be getting any better. The writing feels very like first draft debut, and it needs way too much polishing for me to be willing to go through this. So that's just a big fat no from me. The next book that I read was Before They Are Hanged by Joe Abercrombie. This is the second book in the First Law trilogy. This is my third time reading it. I think I'm posting this video first, but I have filmed a review for this. As I have said now a couple times, I am reviewing all of the First Law books this year, finally. So that will be coming your way. I love Joe Abercrombie's books. Suffice to say, I love this. Previously, I had this at 4 stars. I bumped it up to a 5 because every time I read these books, I love them more. And, this was probably, well, I did read Stone Sky, but Stone Sky was intense. I honestly, like, the thing that I found most joy in reading this month was probably this. The next book I read was Deathless Divide by Justina Ireland. This was a buddy read with Mara from Books Like Low, and we both of us really, really loved this book. I think both of us liked Dread Nation slightly more, but considering what we'd heard from other people about what a step down this was, compared to the first book, we were pleasantly surprised. Like, we did like the first one better, but not by that much. And the reason that we liked this the second one less was more to do with structure and the pacing, and less to do with the story. Because there's a big time jump that occurs. And Mara suggested, and I ended up agreeing. At first I was like, I don't know, but the more I thought about it, the more I agreed that it would have felt more organic for a time jump like that to happen between books. So perhaps this should have been a trilogy instead of duology, and have this second book end where that time jump occurs, and then have a third book explore what happens after the time jump, and just kind of flesh those out a bit more, instead of cramming them both into one book, and it just being this jarring break, where suddenly we've moved a bunch of time. So from that standpoint, yeah, like, the first one, there was no structural flaw like that, it was just a knockout. This was still really excellent. The themes and the character work that are being handled here this is what YA should be and could be and often isn't. There are very dark and complex ideas and themes present, but they're handled in a way that's approachable and appropriate for the age group that it is marketed and geared towards, without feeling like it's talking down, without being juvenile, without being in some way trite or cleaned up. It's still messy and it's still dark. It's quite dark, but it doesn't feel inappropriately dark for YA. It doesn't feel like one of those where you're like, should this be YA? It feels like it's YA because it feels like it's handling it in a way that doesn't shy away from showing you how ugly these things can be, but still handles it in a way that is sensitive to the age of the people that will be reading this. Oh my goodness, so, so good. This duology is so, so, so good. I still gave this 5 stars. I think Mara gave it a lower rating than she gave the first book, but I give this duology 5 stars, basically. And like, did I like this one less? Maybe 4.5 stars. But in Goodreads, like, you can't do half stars, so I always round up, so it's still 5 stars. The next book that I read was Gardens of the Moon by Stephen Erickson. I gave this 3 stars. I have extremely mixed feelings about it. I will be posting a video where I talk about this book with my father, because we buddy read it. And I will most likely be posting another video that's a discussion video that's related to this, but I haven't totally planned that out yet, so I don't want to say. But, so I will be talking about this more. I say that because, like, I don't really want to talk about it too much here now, because, well, for one, I haven't filmed the video with my father yet. I don't want a situation where, like, I say something here and now, and then during the course of that video, like, filming that video, like, maybe my dad will change my mind about some things. I don't know. But right now, I have very mixed feelings about this. I do want to read more Malazan books, but I would... I have issues. Everyone is surprised. So in any case, more in-depth discussion and thoughts will be shared in the video that I film with my father that will be coming to you soon. The next book that I read was From Blood and Ash by Jennifer Armentrout. I have a very lengthy video talking about this book because I vlogged reading it. There's also the live show on Amanda's channel where me and Mara and Bethany and Amanda all talked about it because this was the Blades and Bodice Rippers book club book. So my thoughts and feelings have been shared in great depth and detail already. So I hated this, gave it 1 star. It's one of the worst things I've ever read. If you want to know why, check out those other videos. The next book that I read was Shadow of Night by Deborah Harkness. This is the second book in the All Souls trilogy, which starts with A Discovery of Witches. I didn't love A Discovery of Witches, but the way it ended, I was curious to see where the next one would go, and I'm curious to watch the second season of the show. So since I read the first book before watching the first season of the show, I wanted to read the second book before watching the second season of the show. And I hated it. I hated it so much. I thought there was a good chance that I'd like this better than the first one because of where it would be taking place. And I hated it. Oh my god, I hated it. This book had, like, no redeeming qualities. It is everything I hate about how historical fiction is done badly. It's everything I hate about how romance is done badly. It's everything I hate about how supernatural and speculative romance is done badly. I hated it so much. So much that I don't even want to rant about it. It's the kind of thing where, like, maybe I should post a rant review, but I don't want to spend any more time thinking about it. I hated it so, so much. It makes me so angry. And it was a lot of similar feelings that I had from Blood and Ash. And I've already spent so much time just, like, in the headspace of hating that I don't want to spend any more time there. I spent enough time while reading this and while talking about From Blood and Ash. But it was bad. There's nothing redeeming about it. The first book had some redeeming qualities. Found the Oxford setting interesting. There was some humorous moments. There was some interesting lore being built about the supernatural creatures. Some interesting ideas about how they would, like, exist in our world. All of that's gone now. Now it just became the most cliche, stupid, trite, tropey thing. And I wanted to be sick reading it. I just pushed through so that I could at least get another book read for my reading goal for 2020 out of this. So it wouldn't be a complete waste of my time. The next book that I read was A Rogue of One's Own by Evie Dunmore. I was hesitant to pick this up because I didn't really like Bringing Down the Duke, which was the first in this series by Evie Dunmore. Mainly because of the questionable consent in the romance in the first book. So I asked around and was told that I'd probably like this better because, like, well, that questionable consent thing wasn't there. And I did like it better for that reason. But I didn't love it. Like, romance for romance's sake isn't just not a thing I look for or seek out. So there's quite a few romance-y books that I've liked, but it's because I think that the humor in it is fantastic or the character work is fantastic or a combination thereof. Maybe it's great world building. Like, a love story just for a love story's sake, I don't really get anything out of it. It's not something I seek out. And that's kind of what this was. Like, it wasn't especially, like, witty dialogue. Like, there were some moments that were kind of witty, but, like, not enough to, like, super entertain me. The plot was as predictable as a romance typically is. Like, you could kind of guess every turn that it would take, and it did. So usually because of the predictability of romances, it is the journey that you're there for. It's the author's ability to make the journey enticing, entertaining, whatever. That is what keeps you reading. And I just, it was fine. I didn't love the characters. I wasn't super invested in anything that was going on with them. They didn't leap off the page in any way. It was fine. I kind of immediately forgot about it as soon as I finished it. I was like, yeah, it was fine. And the last book that I read was The Girl in the Tower by Katherine Arden. This is the second book in the Winter Night trilogy, which began with The Bear and the Nightingale and concludes with The Winter of the Witch. I think I kind of didn't pick it up immediately when it came out because the cover is so pink. And also, I thought Bear and the Nightingale was a standalone. So I was kind of surprised when I learned that it wouldn't be. And so I was like, okay, well, there's another book. Well, I want it. And then it came out and I was like, yeah, it's so pink. I was like, I mean, I want to read it, but I'll get to it. And then so much time passed that I, like, forgot The Bear and the Nightingale, so I had to reread it. So I did, as you know, if you watched my wrap-up from last month, I loved it even more the second time and jumped right into this. And I read this almost all in one day. Like, I technically read, like, the first 40 pages a different day, and then I read all the rest of it in one day. And it's a knockout. It's so good. I don't know if I could say it's better than Bear and the Nightingale, but it's different. And that was a pleasant surprise to me, because, like, if it had just been kind of more of the same, I would still have been well pleased by that, because Bear and the Nightingale is great. So more of same when same is good. you know, a second helping of the same dish that was a tasty dish, still good. But this was bringing in new themes and new scenery and new places, new characters, new Russian folklore, and handling it just as well as the first book, but different. Bringing in new themes, aging it up, not in like, because it's still adult fantasy, like it's not like it wasn't already adult fantasy, but aging up the character, because like Vasya is, she's older now, she's, because she's experienced more of the world, then she grows as a character. And so like growing the folklore and growing the story and growing the world with the character and like having the folkloric elements reflect this growth in the character and the handling of like Russian history, I suppose. Because like there, this is, it's this magical realism. This isn't a fantasy world inspired by Russia the way that the Grishaverse is. This is meant to be Russia, but with some fantastical elements present. So the handling of sort of how, like the pieces of it that are non-magical, just like the Russian elements. It's very immersive once again, but again, different. So Bear and the Nightingale is very rural Russia. This is more, this takes place largely in Moscow. So having sort of the city life, if you will, of old-timey Russia was beautifully described and immersively described and frustratingly described in how not exactly feminist the place and time were. It was a dazzling read, and I am so excited to read the third book in this trilogy because I can only imagine it's going to be just as good and yet new again, and I can't wait to find out how. So yeah, those are all the books that I read in February. I apologize if there are noises in this video because I live in downtown Los Angeles and it's been a very noisy day. So I've tried to stop and start as much as I could to cut that out, but I'm only human. Also, it's been a kind of a cloudy / sunny day, so I'm sure the lighting shifted throughout the video. Again, I apologize for that. There's only so much I can do. I don't have a professional studio with professional lighting. Anywhoosies, yeah, let me know in the comments down below if you read any of the books that I read, if you want to read any of the books that I read, if you hated any of the books that I loved or loved any of the books that I hated, or if you felt the exact same way, whatever you want to let me know. I post videos on Saturdays, other random times as well, but definitely Saturdays. So like and subscribe, and I'll see you when I see you. Bye.